Okay then, ladies and gentlemen, we're on with the show. I'm going to take you through some old school pyromusical techniques. So we've got some contents I'm going to go through. We're going to have a quick look at the history of fireworks and pyromusical. Then we look at the equipment that used to, the sort of equipment we used to be stuck with before we got the super duper swizzy things we've got these days. How you then have to plan your display, taking into account the sort of equipment you had, the sort of fusing you might have to use. We've got an example video and then a few final thoughts. So hopefully this won't take very long. Right, so back in the depths of history, back at the dawn of time, before the interweb, before laptop computers, before even the 286 processor. Right, man created fire and fireworks. See, we saw that they were good, but something was lacking. And as Chris said, the missing thing is music. We can add a whole lot more to the actual show by including music. So hence, pyromusicals were born. So the equipment that used to be available before the digital age, you had quite basic firing systems, so no super-duper electronic systems. You'd have a very limited number of channels available to you. At best, you'd have a battery and some switches. At worst, it would literally be a nail board. You see nails banged into a bit of wood, wires connected to that, and you connect up the negative and positive terminals of a car battery and just flick through the nails and eventually fire your show. I have fired pyromusical with a nail board before now. In fact, it was my last pyromusical I had to fire because everything else went wrong. To a live audience as well, live orchestra. It was interesting, yes. Right, and when they had come with the musical systems, it was back to vinyl records and turntables. If you were a bit good, you could get a cassette tape and produce a mixtape. Compact disc players then came along, but this is before the time when you could actually record your own CD and mix the music onto that. And if you were lucky, you might get a mini disc, which was the predecessor of that, which you could actually record onto. But once again, it's still very much press play on your source material and record on the other one and juggle the two until you got the mix you wanted. And then to actually match in with that, all you could use was a stopwatch. So you'd have your stopwatch and you'd have your firing plan. You'd have a show caller whose job it was to look at the stopwatch and look at the firing plan and literally call the show, say, stand by, channel one, fire. And then you have your show firer who sat there with the switches, and when he's ready on channel one, when he's told to, as soon as channel one's ready, fire it. Stand by channel two, dunk, 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 fire. And you work your way through the show like that. That way, the actual show caller is normally the guy who's designed it, me in the sort of cases. You only get to see the finale, because the show to you is just a piece of paper, and you're looking at it, and you go, grand finale, stand by, fire. Well, that was nice. What's the rest of the show like? So. Right, now the sort of basic planning that I use the sort of grid system where I've got the middle, left and right of the show. Put my timings in, as you can see on there. And it gives a sort of a vague visual representation of what the show's going to look like with the descriptions and things. And over here I have my general notes about how long is it going to take. I mean, because I've got a very reduced number of channels, I've only got 20 channels available. I use 1 to 10 as my front of house, and then 11 to 20 is the sort of rear and shells, mines, that sort of thing. So, up the front, up the top here, we've got channel one. We've got two things firing at the same time. However, this one has actually got a 17-second, believe it or not, it does say 17, a 17-second delay. So I want them to light up at the same time. Delay burns down, and then the second one will take over 17 seconds after the first one. As Chris said, it's very important also to actually have fireworks stop when you want them to, when it's sort of to match the music. So you see this one here, I've made a note, it runs out at 59 seconds, assuming it's lit up at the right time, at 19 seconds over there. And this plan has been put together, as you can see, to go with the piece of music called Inside by Stiltskin. And it's been planned so that it is a slight delay to allow for the actual fuses to take up. So if you've got a candle bundle, there's a few seconds allowed for the flame to get into the fuses before the actual effects start launching. Now, hopefully, we've got the music will actually work on this now. Yep. So I'm highlighting each bit as it's due to occur within the show. And obviously, it lights up a little bit early to allow for the fuses to burn in, so. So you see the yellow dragon candles, they lit up just before the quiet bit comes in.
Swing low in a dark glass hour, you turn and cower, see it turn to dust. Move on a stone dark night, we take to flight, snowfall turns to rust. Seeming a fuse in my like a nursing rhyme. Fat man starts to fall, here in a hostile place, I hear your face start to call. And if you think that I've been losing my way, that's because I'm slightly blinded.
So it gives you an idea where you're getting the music to start, and well, the effects to start, and then because you've timed it and you work out where it runs out to stop on the particular bits of the music, so you get distinct effects with the different elements of the music, as Chris pointed out. So, because you've got a limited number of channels, you have to get quite creative with the fusing. If you've got 100 effects you want, but you've only got 20 channels, there's some disparity there, so you're going to have to somehow get it all to work. So, with plus the igniter chord, that's all well and good for linking up fairly long delays for the sort of what I sort of call the fillers, the sort of the baseline of your display that's sort of just there to just, it's almost the fireworks with music element, and then you use your more accurate bits for the on the beat. So it's sort of your filler stuff, it's okay for that. It's not particularly, the actual fuse itself is perfectly accurate. The problem is telling where you've ignited it and where it's actually going to squirt off into the quick match to set off your main effect. Because that's a little bit variable because of its plastic sheathing. You never know quite where it's lighting, and therefore you don't know exactly how long the delay is going to be. So you have to allow for that and say, allow a slack and tolerance in the show. you can actually accurately cut Bickford fuse or some similar stuff to give you fairly accurate delays, but I wouldn't want to go much below 1 second on this because then you've got a piece of fuse that's only this long, and actually stopping the quick match from hitting one end of it and flashing straight past it into the next bit is quite difficult. So you have an awful lot of binding and it's quite fiddly. So you want to look at other techniques for less than 1 second delays. And the techniques that I've used is a choked quick match, where you literally just take your quick match and you bind it really tightly, either with string or put a bit of heat shrink over it and shrink it down really tight. And what this does, it stops the actual envelope of the quick match inflating and allowing the flame to flash along it. And what it does, it closes it down, and then it becomes just a black powder burning fuse through that section. And you can either do this as straight, or you can bend it in a figure, in an S shape, and then bind that up tight. And you can get fairly accurate delays down to about a quarter of a second, which is normally close enough for your pyromusical bits. This is a little demo, and I'll try and talk you through some of these bits here. So this is the sort of filler stuff, just a few candles to keep going. And I'm sure you know the music, so you know it's going to get interesting in a minute, like the anticipation that Chris said. So there you go. So we have the mines there, and then these fan cake that's all wired together to fire off there. And this bit here, the actual firing sequence, as you said, just fire stuff. Because we actually had five people out on the ground lighting fuses, and it was just, you've got these to fire within this 30-second gap, so just get on with it. So you couldn't actually match it to the music with the technology we had. And the trick is to get them to have got all of that done, so that then when you can get back into the music and get it accurate with the music, you're able to do so. So now we're starting to come back into the bit where we can actually time it properly. Each of these groups is a few sequence, so I'm actually very proud of the way this worked. And I always like to end with a Kimura or brocade shell because I think they look fantastic. And a few noisy ones just to let them know it's definitely over. Now that last brocade there was actually a 16-inch one, back in the days when you could. It was wonderful. Right. So final thought. Now, let's say this was all about old school stuff, the way it used to be done, but it's still quite relevant today, I find. So my recommendation is to use digital, but only where you need to use digital. If you can keep it simple, do so. You can, by using these techniques and the fusing and things, you can minimise an awful lot of cable lengths, less spaghetti going everywhere. So it makes your life a lot easier on the ground and then actually setting up on the day. And also for live music events, using this sort of technique, you can actually, if you've got a crew member who can actually read music and follow the actual conductor as he's going away and the actual speed of the music, it allows you to actually do a live event and use some of these techniques rather than a fully computerised system. I've tried to do pyromusicals with a live orchestra. I've practiced it over and over, gone through it, and then when you actually get there and you actually hear them playing it, you think, they're considerably slower or considerably faster than the music I've been practicing with. Bugger. And what you normally have to do is actually drag the conductor off, sit him down in your car and play him the CD in the car and say, this is how fast you need to do it, all right? But I'll say, it's much better. If you've actually got a crew member who can read music, you can actually get them to mark up a score. You play them the music, they're right, I want the channels firing here. They'll mark up the score accordingly, and then they can sit there and call the show using the old-fashioned technique rather than the stopwatch. They're using their ear, listening to the music, going, standby channel one, fire, etc., etc.